All right, I think we can all agree that it's a no-brainer that Alexis Lafreniere will be the first overall pick in the NHL draft this year. Really, the only unknown at this point is when exactly he will be drafted, because, well, there still won't even be games played again for another 2 months, let alone when they're going to actually complete the playoffs, so this is still a ways away. But at least with the return play plan that was released recently, we did get some clarity on who the main draft lottery teams are. And now that we know those 7 teams, well, 6 since Ottawa owns San Jose's pick, we felt that it would be a good time to bring back a video that we did in the past for the Rasmus Dahlin draft, and go over which one of these basement teams needs Lafreniere more. Whatever team is fortunate enough to win the draft lottery is going to get an elite playmaker in Lafreniere, and a player who will make an immediate impact and become a cornerstone of that franchise. Hi, it's Matt from Puck Rivals, and in this video, me and Billy are going to be analyzing the lottery team's current strengths and weaknesses, and where Lafreniere would be a good fit and be able to make an impact. Make sure to watch till the end to see which teams we think need Lafreniere the most. But with that, let's get into the team evaluations. Now, starting off with Detroit, we have a team that hasn't been good in a few years, and this year was exceptionally bad, finishing with 39 points in 71 games before the season was shut down. Now, this is a team that needs a lot of help and does have a lot of holes, but they do still have some strengths, even though they've been so bad. Looking at their strengths, they do still have a few young prospects in guys like Philip Zadina and Moritz Seider. They do have some current good players in their lineup too, and Dylan Larkin and Anthony Mantha. But looking at each positional group, they don't really have any strengths anywhere. They have 2 older goalies, they have a lack of depth defensively, and a lack of depth offensively as well. So really, we're just looking at guys like Larkin and Mantha, and I guess a sense of hope that they can hopefully get this pick. They are still years away from being a contender, but getting a guy like Lafreniere would definitely speed up this process, and it would actually give the team a bona fide star to build around. And that's no slight to Dylan Larkin or Anthony Mantha, but they don't have the kind of ceiling that Lafreniere has. If Detroit gets number one pick, it's definitely one that they deserve after being so exceptionally bad this year. So now on to Ottawa, the team that didn't finish last but does have the best odds at getting this first overall pick because they own San Jose's first round pick as well as their own. Now, even though they finished second last in the league, this Ottawa team still has a lot of upside, especially looking into the future. And the main reason for that is they have one of the best prospect pools in the NHL. They already have some young, great impact players on their current team with high ceilings, like Brady Tkachuk and Thomas Chabot. They're a very young group that has potential to play together for a very long time. And not to mention, in this draft, they have a potential 7 picks in the first 2 rounds, the one potential being the Islanders winning the draft lottery. So most likely they'll have those 7 picks in the first 2 rounds in this draft, just building in that prospect pool even more. Now, they still do have some big decisions to make, one of that being goaltending. Craig Anderson is 39 years old, his contract is expiring this year, and they don't really have anyone in their current system that can take that starter role right now. So the question is, do they sign Anderson for another year? Does he even want to stay? Do they have to go to free agency? So that leaves a major question mark on a team that's trending upward. And also, they are still missing blue line depth at this point, but that will come once prospects like Brännström get some more seasoning. So again, this team is just well set for the future, but still has some more development and growing pains to go through. So if Ottawa was fortunate enough to get the first overall pick, Lafreniere would join and lead an already talented prospect pool. He's a playmaker who would likely find good chemistry with a player like Brady Tkachuk. And also, he has that superstar potential forward that their current forward group is missing. So this would be absolutely huge if Ottawa is able to get him. And by having 2 picks in this lottery, they set themselves in the best position possible. Now, this LA team is interesting because they do have some good, experienced players who can still play. Well, some of them can. And they are building up the prospect pool at the exact same time. But going in detail about their strengths, they do still have experienced players like Anze Kopitar and Drew Doughty who are still very capable and very good players in the league. But they just need some help. So they've been doing that in a different way by trading away veterans to get picks and build up their prospect pool. So they now have players in their pipeline like Rasmus Kupari, Alex Turcotte, and Tobias Bjornfoot. So it's just weird, they're building for the future while also having those impact players in the present as well. And this flip-flopping has led to a lot of weaknesses in the team. They have no depth on the blue line behind Doughty, their best players are all 30 or over, and they have an aging and inconsistent goalie in Quick right now. And they have one of the league's worst offenses, and struggle to score. To be specific, they finished 30th in goals for this year, with 178. So they need help. Adding Lafreniere to be injecting his playmaking ability and skill and could work well with older experienced players like Kopitar, and it balances out their forward group a little more by spacing out the heavy lifting for generating offense. Having Lafreniere being able to play top line minutes will push players down who were forced to play higher roles who didn't have the skill level to succeed there. And we saw that this year on LA. So having a player like Lafreniere would be able to inject some youth in the lineup as early as next year and can gain experience from those veterans that can still play too, so they could definitely find success if they do manage to win this draft lottery. So with that, I'm going to send it over to Billy to go over the last three teams and then reveal who we think needs Lafreniere the most. So let's get started with the next team.
Thanks, Matt. Now, the next team to be covered in the bottom six is the Anaheim Ducks. And despite finishing as low as they did this year, the Ducks are actually not that bad at the back end of the ice. They boast one of the best goaltenders in the league in John Gibson, and have a pretty good top three in their decor in the form of Hampus Lindholm, Cam Fowler, and Josh Manson, with young guys like Brendan Gooley and Jacob Larson ready to step into the lineup as well. It's up front where the Ducks need the most help. That being said, the Ducks do possess some good young players up front in the lineup, but there isn't really any standouts among them. Now, this doesn't include Trevor Zegras, the Ducks' top prospect, who certainly looks like he could become an impact forward in their top six. The problem for the Ducks is that their better forwards now aren't getting any younger. Getzlaff is in his mid-30s, Silverberg will be 30 by next season, and Ricard Raquel is in his prime right now at this moment. Combining this with no real top-line young players in their lineup, adding Lafreniere would inject immediate help with creating offense and give them a young star to lead the rest of their young forward group. The Devils are a team that already contained two of the last three first overall picks in their lineup, Nico Hischier and Jack Hughes, who are among a few young skilled forwards. Others, for example, include Jesper Boqvist, who should be ready for the NHL full-time soon, and Jesper Bratt, who still has some upside to his name. Another strength the Devils have on their side is the emergence of Mackenzie Blackwood, who is displaying that he does have the ability to be that number one goalie they've needed since Schneider's unfortunate downfall. Blackwood's performances are even more impressive when you take into account that their current D group has been pretty weak in front of them. This Devils team is fairly young and unproven, especially since Hall is now gone after carrying the team to the playoffs in 2018. What Lafreniere can do for New Jersey is add to a young and talented forward group and play on the wing with either Hughes or Hischier to create quite the dynamic duo. Adding him can help them make a push into playoff contention sooner rather than later. The Sabres. Do I dare call them the new Edmonton? Anyways, as we know, the Sabres boast some very good star players they have drafted with their previous high draft picks, such as Jack Eichel and Rasmus Dahlin. They have managed to shore up their defensive group over the years, and actually finishing above teams like Nashville or Washington this year in terms of goals against per game. This is also taking into account Buffalo's biggest weakness, in the goal crease. They took a gamble on Carter Hutton as a free agent, but that hasn't really panned out at all. Linus Ullmark looked decent this year, but he will have to prove that over the next few years. Their top goalie prospect, Luukkonen, is still so young as well and a few years away from being able to take the crease at the big league level. Another thing that has been hampering the Sabres is their lack of offensive depth. Who could help with that? Alexis Lafreniere. He could easily provide scoring depth that they desperately need, and it would give the Sabres one of the deadliest top 6 groups in the league. Maybe they could try to adopt a Leafs-like style, score a ton of goals each game, and hope that their iffy goaltending doesn't allow more than that. After running through each of the bottom 6 teams, Matt and I made our choices who we think needs Lafreniere the most. We determined this through two different ways. Who needs him the most to push them over the hump and get into the postseason, and who needs him the most based on survival or for the rebuild. Let's start with the easy one. It's so clear the Red Wings need Lafreniere the most based on the state of their team and rebuild. They have so many holes to fill, and adding a potential superstar alongside Larkin and Mantha can only help speed up the rebuilding process. In terms of becoming a legitimate contender and getting over the hump, we believe the Sabres or Ducks need Lafreniere the most. The Sabres were the closest team to the postseason out of the bottom six, and with their star power combined with a new up-and-coming superstar, It'd be hard to imagine that they'd still be chilling at the bottom of the standings. The Ducks are pretty well built at the back end of the ice, and adding an offensive dynamo such as Lafreniere into their current and future forward group might just push them over the edge into playoff contention. Let us know who you believe needs Lafreniere the most based on the two criteria that we have mentioned. And as always, if you like hockey videos, don't forget to like and subscribe, because that's what we do around here. See you next time. We'll be right back.